The educator Dr. Maria Montessori once said,
"The child developing harmoniously and the adult improving himself at his side make a very exciting and attractive picture."
Welcome to Montessori Education with me, Jesse McCarthy, where we talk raising children and educating students while bettering ourselves right alongside them.
I have a few vivid memories from childhood of being completely alone with other children, so without adults, whether I was with friends just, you know, walking home from elementary school, or when I was like maybe 8 or 9 exploring these, they were like water runoff tunnels near my apartment complex, or biking to the candy store around that same age. And all these memories are pretty positive for me, just really good times. Not too many negative ones come to mind. Well, there's one actually that I was being chased down by some teenage punk. That was pretty scary, actually. But anyways, my guest today, research professor Peter Gray with Boston College, would say children need much more of this kind of time on their own without adult supervision. And in a lot of his study and teaching, including in his internationally used textbook titled Psychology, Peter discusses the vital importance of this freedom for children, especially when it comes to play. Now, Peter is not a Montessorian, though, and his views on just how much free play children should have might seem pretty radical to many. Even for me, and I'll be straight here, I actually think more adult guidance is needed than he thinks, as you might see. So even he and I would have some disagreement. But I really appreciate and agree with his bent, which I'd say is toward getting children more independent experiences in life versus kind of there being surveillance by parents, you know, way too often and kind of lectured at by traditional school teachers. But instead of my telling you more about the man or where Montessori and his approach might coincide or differ, let's just get into it.
So thank you very much for coming on the show, Peter. Happy to have you.
I'm happy to be here.
So I thought maybe we would just hop in, because I know there was this story that you had told about your old friend, very old friend, Ruby Liu. Would you mind telling the audience about that story?
Yeah. So I start off my book, Free to Learn, with this little story from my past. Free to Learn is primarily about the scientific evidence and research, but I start off with a little story from my own life to illustrate some of the points to be made. So when I was 5 years old, we moved to a little town in southern Minnesota, and I was feeling a little lonely, and because I had a next door neighbor friend back in Minneapolis where we were living before who I was missing. And so my mom said, well, why don't you just walk up and down the street knocking on doors and see if there are any kids living in any of these houses or who are about your age. So I did that. I walked up and down the street, knocked on doors. And lo and behold, right across the street from where we were living, a woman came to the door and she said, "Yes, indeed, we have a young girl who's about your age. Her name is Ruby Liu." So Ruby Liu came out and we immediately, that very day, became best friends. And for the 2 years that I lived in that town, she and I were best friends, played together just about every day. She was just a little bit older than me. I was 5. It turns out she was also 5. In the book, I say she was 6, but I've discovered that she was actually only a few months older than me and was also 5 at the time that we met. So in the story, I tell how I learned so much from Ruby Liu. I describe her as one of the greatest teachers in my life, because I'm making the point that we learn from all of our interactions, and we particularly learn as children from our interactions with other children. So this was back, this was 1949. This is a long time ago when we first moved there. The world was very different then, or at least the world for children. Little children, 5 years old, could go out, knock on people's doors, go up and down the street.
Sounds incredible.
No adults with them. Well, one of the things that I tell about Ruby Liu is that she had a bicycle. I didn't have a bicycle. She had a bicycle. It was a girl's bicycle, which made it a little easier to ride. You didn't have to lift your leg over a bar. And so one of my first memories with Ruby Lou is her teaching me how to ride the bicycle. And she explained to me, she let me use her bicycle. She explained to me there was a little slope on the road between our houses. And she explained to me, if I start at the top of that slope, that'll help me get up enough speed so that I won't fall down right away. And then I can continue pedaling and see how far I can go. And she encouraged me to do that. And I learned to ride a bicycle that way. She also encouraged me. She was, even though she was shorter than I, I've since seen pictures of us together. She was shorter than I. She was a lot braver than I was, and in many ways wiser and so on. And she would encourage me. She was better at tree climbing, and I tried to emulate her to climb trees as high as she could climb them, and so on and so forth. And after I learned how to ride a bicycle, my parents bought me a secondhand old rickety bicycle, and she and I would then take bicycle trips, just us, all over, not only all over town, but even outside of town. The main point I'm trying to make here is that childhood, back in the 1950s, which was primarily the years of my childhood, was very different from today. And childhood throughout history was very different from today. We are in an age where we are involved in a horrid social experiment. What happens if we take play away from children? What happens if we take their freedom away from them? So that they're pretty much always either in school or they're under adult direction outside of school, and they have almost no time to just be children away from adults, figuring out the world themselves, learning how to get along with other people. Much of my research and writing has to do with the fact that children and young adults too are suffering these days because of play deprivation.
Yeah, and I wonder, Peter, is there, I mean, the bicycle, story is interesting because it's kind of ironic that, bicycle is one of those one things that people recognize as you can't sit down in a classroom and learn how to ride a bicycle. And it seems in this case, you're learning from, a fellow five-year-old, but there's a broader point about how we learn as human beings, that you have to actually do things. So I'm curious, is that a part of the play issue, or is that kind of another element of it? Or what do you see that as in terms of learning?
None of the really important things that we have to learn can you learn in a classroom. It's not just riding a bicycle. It's how to get along with other people, how to solve your own problems, how to discovering your real passionate interests. You can't learn that in the classroom. You have to be able to explore and do and play things. Mm-hmm. You can't develop a passionate interest when you're forced to study things in a classroom. How to get along with other people is the most important thing. And if there's an adult there solving your problems for you, you're not learning how to do it. I would say the main thing that children develop through freedom away from adults is what's called an internal locus of control, which means I can take charge of my own life. I can solve my own problems. I can figure things out myself. I don't need a powerful other person to do things for me. I'm not a victim of fate and circumstance. I can be in charge of my own life. There's actually a psychological test for clinical questionnaire that assesses the degree to which people have this internal locus of control. Yeah. And no surprise, ever since this test was developed, actually around 1960, the scores on internal locus of controls for school-age children has been continuously going down. And I am convinced that this is because they're not allowed to take control of their own lives. They're always being controlled. They're always being told what to do. Yeah. And this sense of I can solve my own problems, I can figure things out, I can take responsibility for my own life, this is way more important than the academic things that you learn in school. The academic things you learn in school are easy to learn once you have learned to take control of your own life.
Yeah. And Peter, talking about, because, obviously, this is the Montessori Education Podcast. So a lot of what I cover is related to Montessori. So when you say classroom, I'm assuming this is the kind of traditional idea of a classroom where the teacher's at the front, basically ordering a child's day each and every moment. I mean, or do you see it as it's impossible to kind of gain this locus of control and so forth in a quote classroom? Because I'm just wondering the definition of a classroom versus, Montessori, one of the core elements, with Maria Montessori, and then just in how we approach education with children, is that that locus of control that you're talking about, it is the creation of a child's self. Like, he must be directing his day with our guidance, but he has to be directing his day or that's not going to develop. So I'm curious your take on that.
Yeah, well, there are degrees of it. I think children need, whether they're going to a Montessori school or a regular school, they need time completely away from adults, away from adults, where there's not going to be some adult looking over their shoulder and solving the problem for them, judging them, and so on and so forth. I think Montessori schools, to the degree that I understand them, I visited a couple of them, one very recently in Omaha. One thing about that I'm sure you know about Montessori schools is they differ a lot from school to school. So it's hard it's hard to generalize. Some of them, there's a lot of freedom. Some of them are pretty rigid. I've known a couple of people who used to teach in Montessori schools and left because they found it too rigid for the students. But I've also seen this one in Omaha, where the kids were really very, very free. And it was clear that they were in control of much of their activities in that setting. So I think that's an improvement. That's not my own interest is in self-directed education, which I just with capital letters, which to me is different from Montessori or any other kind of progressive schools in that the adults do not take responsibility, even in the long run, for children's learning, that children are responsible for their own education. The adults are there just to sort of be the adults in the environment. So that's the Sudbury Valley School, where I've done research, and there are many other schools modeled after that. So there are degrees of the extent to which children are free to follow their own interests without a sense of being judged and evaluated. And Montessori is certainly a great improvement, in my view, from the conventional schools.
And I'm curious, because what you said, I think, makes a lot of sense in terms of even in the best Montessori schools I've been to, there every now and again is a time when a child might look over his shoulder and go, I wonder if, you know, the teacher's watching, you know, because they're going to do something a little bit mischievous or something like that.
Right,
so
the
larger point in terms of, I think, based on what I've read from you and just thinking about, you know, definitely be pre-civilized man and so forth, is that children need to be completely away from adults at times, kind of like you and Ruby Lou riding the bicycle. There wasn't somebody going, oh, well, I hope somebody doesn't fall. So that's a completely different thing. And I'm curious, even in terms of the school that you're talking about that was completely self-directed, you still believe, even on top of that, there needs to be time when children are just at the park on their own, running around a mall when they're older, that type of thing. Is that what you're referring to?
Right. Yeah. But at this school that I've studied, it pretty much is that way. There are a few adults, but they're not watching the kids. The kids are outdoors playing and exploring on their own. And there are no adults watching them. So it really is that kind of a situation. It's no different from when Ruby Lou and I were playing outdoors or riding our bikes around town, but our moms were home if we needed to go back to them. So
And I think that would be like another discussion, because I think it would be interesting to kind of dive deep into that.
Sure.
And even in terms of, you know, who are the people there versus can that be systematized given that it's the nature of the adults that are in that particular school and so forth. But, but I definitely get the point in terms of, I think we're both on the end of the spectrum as children need to have a lot more self-directed activities in their day than what's happening in our country and in our world, really. Definitely since the 40s and 50s. So what do you say? I mean, even in terms of talking about play, I mean, even within Montessori, people say, oh, well, the children are just playing all day, or somebody will say, oh, no, they're quote working. So what is your idea of play? So we can just be clear on what that would even mean for children.
Yeah, I'll try to keep this brief. Sometimes I'll give a 1-hour talk on what is play. So I'll avoid that. I'll just give you I'll give you the short form of it.
Cool.
Play, in my definition, and that really of other play scholars, if you come right down to it, although I've kind of articulated the definition this way, is an activity that has the following four characteristics. The first characteristic is that it's self-chosen and self-directed. You know, so right off, if an adult is telling you to do it, If yeah, adult,
organized soccer game is not going to be part of it.
An organized soccer game is not play. If a teacher stands up in front of the classroom and says, "Now, children, we're all going to play this," it's not play, right? Okay. So, So right off, you could see also from this what one of the among the most important things that children learn in play is how to initiate their own activities, how to direct their own activities, and when they're playing together, which children prefer, almost always prefer to play with other children, they have to direct, they have to choose together, which means they have to negotiate. I want to play this, you want to play that, and so on and so forth. Well, what do we both want to play? And I want to play this way, you want to play. So there's an enormous amount of negotiation, compromise, learning to respect the other person's opinion, as well as getting your own needs across. These are terribly important skills that are ruined if adults take charge.
and all towards a goal that the children actually develop themselves or came up
all
with themselves.
All towards the goal that the children develop themselves. So your example of adults, so if, you know, when I'll take the example of baseball because that's what I played as a kid. And so we would play baseball and it would be play. We'd go out to the vacant lot. There would be no adults there. There's no manicured baseball field. There's just grass there and probably junk. And there's so you're out in this vacant lot. There's a house over in one direction with windows that could get broken. Maybe there's a busy street on another border. So you develop all these ground rules. There's not going to be 18 people. You choose up sides, figure out how you're going to do. Maybe you have one person catch for both teams and so on and so forth. Not everybody has a glove. Somebody's got a bat. Somebody's got a ball, which might not be a real baseball.
And what are the ages, by the way?
And the ages might range from 5 to 16. Right?
Wow. Okay.
And so you typically the age range would be less than that, but it might be that much. It more likely would be like 5 to 13 or 8 to 16. So you, and some of them are really good baseball players, some of them are no good, not good at all. You figure out a way to make it fun for everybody. So you have to pitch softly to the little kids. You know, even your own teammates would criticize you if you pitched hard to the little kids. They're not going to have any fun. They're going to leave the game, and then the game is going to get ruined. You've got and the whole point of the thing is to have fun. Everybody's stretching their skills. They're doing their best within the ground rules that you've created. So maybe in one of the places we played baseball, there was this guy who was really, really good at baseball. But because he could clobber the ball, the only way it could be interesting was he would bat left-handed with a broomstick. So think of all the things that kids are learning in that. Now, contrast that to Little League baseball. The adults are doing it all. They're setting up the field. Organized. They're choosing sides. They're calling balls or strikes. There's none of this negotiation going on. There's not. All you can learn in that game is, you know, how to slide into second base or throw a curveball, which you shouldn't do anyway if you're under about 15 years old because it's hard on your elbow. And you're learning something about baseball. But what percentage of people are actually going to go on making a career with baseball, you know?
Yeah, and you know, and what you said too, because I mean, I've been around children for so many years. When we do step back, because I've seen this time and again, what you said about, you know, that great player, this happens. It happens all the time. Some child will come out there, whether he's older or younger, and he's, you know, he's well beyond everybody else, whether he's practicing outside of school. And those other kids just won't have it. Like if he goes full force in the game, those other kids, like, I'm leaving. Because it's just they don't want it. So then, what you're saying, he has to adapt. So this guy's like, well, maybe I'll learn a new skill. I'll hit with the other hand.
Exactly. Yeah. And oftentimes the older kid will even initiate that change because it's no fun for him to go all out. It's only fun for him if he's challenging his. You know, I just to give you another brief example. I was at this school that I talk about. There's a lot of age mix play that goes on, and there was I was watching a game where there was a 16-year-old. Really good basketball player who could dunk the ball if he wanted to. And there were a whole slew of 6 to 8 year olds. And he had one of these little kids on his team. And then there was a horde of the other kids on the other team. And they were playing in such a way that he would never shoot. He only dribbled among this horde of little kids who were delightedly trying to get the ball away from him. And he would set up his one teammate. And that made the game fun and even. And because he was playing, he could, you know, the little kids wouldn't really be able to organize a game themselves and make it work. Wow. But he could keep it organized. He could keep it going. And he was developing his skills of dribbling through all these little kids, you know, and setting up his teammate. And all the other little kids were, they would sometimes get a basket because there's so many of them that they could get free. So it was.
So- I'm curious, Peter, because I know a lot of the audience will have very young children. So I'm curious, why do you think, because I know this to be the case with most parents, 3, 4, 5-year-old, the idea of them playing, even with a 9-year-old, often it's, well, aren't they going to get hurt? You know, there's definitely a fear that, or get picked on, because I know that bullying is a huge thing now.
Yeah.
Do you think that actually happens naturally, or do you think that's more coming from us adults and a concern about protecting our children?
Well, the research indicates that there's less bullying in an age-mixed play than there is in same-age play. Mm-hmm. And especially what it indicates is that older kids are nicer when younger kids are around. They're nicer to the younger kids, but they're even nicer to one another when there's younger kids around. Some of my own research shows that, but there are studies, anthropologists have done studies showing this.
And anecdotally, that's definitely been true in my experience in Montessori with the mixed age classes.
The younger kids bring out the nurturing instinct in the older kids. So in truth, the younger kids are safer if they're playing with older kids. The older kids are looking out for them. They're helping them. They're, you know, and so I think that it's far safer to let kids, and you know, historically, age segregated play is a new thing. And that throughout human history, when our play instincts involved, you never would be segregated by age. It was only with age graded schools that we began to segregate kids by age. Neighborhood play when I was a kid was always age mixed. You know, it's only, and now we're of course segregating kids by age even outside of school. It's one of the worst things we do because, you know, just as I described with Ruby Lou, even though she was only a little bit older than me, she seemed older than me. She's had more skills. She was wiser than me. So I learned so much by interacting with her that I wouldn't have if I was interacting with somebody who was kind of at my same level, who didn't know how to ride a bicycle, who didn't know how to climb trees any better than I did, and so on and so forth.
Yeah, and I would say we definitely have this sense, and even when I was younger and as a teacher, that somehow older children are smarter or more advanced, and it's not always necessarily the case, because as you said with Ruby Lou, and then I just was speaking with somebody who had talked about how a younger child had helped him to learn to read. So it's just this mixed age is kind of like, oh, what's your natural abilities or what have you learned? And I'd love to learn from you. Whether you're older or younger, it doesn't matter, you know?
That's exactly right. And the other thing is when, you know, people think that people who are parents of the older kids worry that the younger kids will sort of lower the older kid's level of behavior. The older kid is going to have to, but in fact, it goes the other way around. The older kid is bringing the younger kid up to his or her level of behavior, not, you know, and finding ways to scaffold the behavior of the younger one. The older one is learning really important skills, how to care for another person, how to be a leader, how to teach things. When you teach something, when you explain how to do something to somebody else, you consolidate it in your own mind. And also, when we're talking about teenagers interacting with younger kids, one of the things that I've observed is that, you know, in our culture, sometimes, especially teenagers who have been to traditional school and they've been kind of burned out and they're cynical and so on, it's hard to be cynical around little lively kids who want you to give them a piggyback ride, you know, and they kind of bring the spirit back to the older kids. They're naturally creative and energetic, and they induce this creative and energetic feeling in the older kids who are playing with them.
Yeah. And I think, I mean, that even goes for us, I think, as adults. I mean, it's one of the things I've found in being in this work is that, you know, when we're around children, I mean, in good environments, because sometimes children can drive, you know, parents kind of crazy at times, but they really do uplift our spirit, as you're saying. And I think the only thing I would say is every now and again, if let's say you had some age segregated class or there's all 5-year-olds or all 6-year-olds, and then there's only one, you know, 9-year-old, I've seen that pull the older child down to their level. But again, that's not a genuine mixed age classroom or mixed age play space if you only have you know, right. one older child, and they're all younger.
Right. No, ideally, like at Sudbury Valley School, where I've done my research, the kids are age 4 through 18, or even sometimes 19, the whole school age range, and they're never segregated from one another. They interact with one another all the time. So unless you're the very oldest or the very youngest kid, everybody's got people who are older than them, younger than them, yes. and the same age as them.
Yeah. And I think if you just think about workspace. I don't know, you know, you in academia and then most people just in whatever careers they have. I always give us the idea that we would somehow just be like, oh, well, all the professors will be 25 or so. It's like, it's just so abnormal, but in education it's become so normalized that it's bizarre to think of mixed age classes for most people.
Exactly. Yeah.
So it's a strange, so one thing I definitely wanted to ask you about, because in Montessori, and I've just seen this through and through, that oftentimes the children will actually view the work that they're doing. This is not work like a teacher's lecturing them, but they're working on some project in the classroom. They will say it feels like play. I mean, I think, you know, Gabriel Garcia Marquez, the famous author, he literally said, because he was a Montessori child, that it felt like play, his work. And I've seen this with children. So I'm curious, even with Ruby Lou, take that, like, in one way, you're working, you're learning how to ride a bicycle, but it's play. So I'm curious, how do you view these two, play versus work? And is there somehow, it's a difficult thing to kind of differentiate, given how most of us adults, or most adults today, not me, but most, view right. work as something, you know, hard and not fun, that type of thing.
Right.
So maybe just a distinction between those two and how you view that.
You know, work, like a lot of English words, has more than one meaning. So, you know, I won't worry about the physical meaning of mass, moving a mass from one place to another.
Yeah.
But the two meanings that are relevant here is work as toil, which means by definition something you don't enjoy doing. This is work, meaning this is something I have to do, but I really would prefer not to do it if I could get away without doing it. Work is toil versus work as something productive. So another way we use the term work is whenever we're doing something productive, something that is having some useful effect on the world, we call it work because we have some kind of a goal to it. Now, the way I would look at this is that when children are truly playing, I would not call it work because their goal, they're not thinking about the production. Even when I was learning how to ride a bicycle, I was only focused on learning how to ride a bicycle. It was the joy of getting on that bicycle and motivating me. I wasn't so much thinking about, this will liberate me and then I'll be able to do and all of this. I'm aiming to learn how to. So. When to the degree that I was doing that, to the degree that I was thinking of that, I would say it was still a very playful activity, but was not 100% play because I was goal oriented. I was doing it for, I didn't finish my definition of play. One part of the definition of play in my definition is that it's intrinsically motivated. So you're doing it just because you want to do it, not because of some end result of doing it.
Yeah.
And so to the degree that you're thinking about an end result, that you're trying to accomplish something that will have a lasting effect beyond this period of play, to that degree, we can call it work by this definition of work as doing something productive. But also to that degree, it's a little bit less fully fits the definition of play. We can call it highly playful, and I'm not opposed to calling it play. But it's a similar thing. So we all know people who refer to their adults who refer to their work, their employment as play. These are people who say, you know, I would do this even if I wasn't paid for it. This is fun. This is meaningful to me. And so what I would say, I'm not opposed to their calling it play, but if I were to be completely technical about it, I would say it's not 100% play. It's pretty close to 100% play, but it is a highly playful activity. And the reason it's not 100% play is if you are truly playing, you're completely free to fail. The product doesn't matter. You're trying to do your best, but there's no problem with not doing your best because there are no real world consequences. But if you are goal-oriented, if you're doing something, if you're now, you know, to take an example of, say, the difference between somebody who's into constructive play, he's building things as a child just for the sake of building things and the fun of building them, versus that same person as an adult who's now getting paid to build things. Mm-hmm. He now has to get it right because he's being paid to get it right. So he can't, yeah. You know, so there's a little bit different. It's a somewhat subtle difference, and I have no complaint about somebody calling that play. But if I'm being completely technical about it, I would say it's not. I would call it highly playful, but not fully play.
Yeah, no, and I think that's an interesting distinction because one day we got to get you in a Montessori classroom and then talk right after that, like in a really good one, because I'm so curious. One of the main ideas, particularly in the young areas, is that, you know, we might see, like, let's say the child's washing a table because that's an actual activity in Montessori. Right. You know, as the adult, you know, an outside viewer, a parent might come in and go, well, the child didn't really, you know, wash that table that well because they're focused on the product, you know, the end result. Uh-huh. Right. And in Montessori, the idea is the teacher might show the child, this is how we wash a table, but they're not expected to wash it perfectly. They're, you know, it's not. So the child, while they're doing it, is not after any end goal. They're just enjoying the process. But it's set up in a way in which, you know, they're learning how to wash a table. But I definitely see the distinction you're making, because that is, I think, a fundamental distinction between adult work and child work. At least in this case, the context is, the adult work, there must be a product, and eventually it must sell, or else you're no longer can do that work because you're not going to be able to survive off of it. That type of thing. So that's intriguing. I haven't heard that distinction, but I think generally speaking, I like that you're adding in there that somebody can think of work as this kind of toiling way, which is, you know, this active movement or whatnot, versus it, work can actually be playful in how you're doing it. So,
you know, along this line, some of my research has been to interview anthropologists who are survey anthropologists who have studied and lived in hunter-gatherer cultures. And these man hunter-gatherer cultures don't even have a word for work, meaning toil, unless it applies to those other people, those farmers or those coal miners and so on.
outside of
themselves. The kids are playing from dawn to dusk, and they gradually move on from playing at hunting and gathering and building huts and building dugout canoes and all the things that they do, that everybody does in that culture, playing at doing it, to gradually really doing it. But there's no point at which they say, they start to use a different term, and they say, now I'm no longer playing, now I'm working. Then they go into their adult lives with the same playful attitude that they took as children engaged in playing at these activities.
Yeah, and you know, in reading your book too, Peter, I love the different analogies you do with these kind of pre-civilized peoples and so forth. And I can definitely see the similarities, particularly because I'm in kind of the Midwest now, and children that are working on farms, you know, they've got a lot of free time to play, but even during their work, they feel like they're in some ways contributing to their community, to their family. They feel that they're a part of it. And I see in a lot of these, you know, these peoples, there's an element of that. Now, do you see that as an important part of childhood, that they're actually a part of the family and doing things as a part of the family that aid the family, not like, well, I'm going to do, you've got your chores and we're going to pay you some, you know, some money, but it's actually a part of the survival or the living of the very family.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And it's not something I have specifically written about, but it's I wrote about it in one blog post. So it is true. I think this is another problem of growing up today. Probably especially in middle class and upper class homes, children are not really expected to contribute to the family. And in the past, I was certainly expected to contribute growing up. We had, you know, I had three brothers, we had four kids. And at one point, a cousin of mine was living with us. We had five kids living up with us. And, you know, we had to do our share of the house cleaning. We had to take our turns cooking and washing dishes. And I was always in charge of mowing the lawn. You know, this was just part of being the family. I wasn't paid special for it. And then the other thing is kids buy 11 or 12, many kids had also part-time jobs. So, yeah. You know, I had a paper route when I was 11, I had a paper route, and beginning when I was 13, I actually was working. By that time we had moved to Duluth, a bigger city. I was actually working after school at a bookbindery company doing deliveries in town. I actually started contributing to Social Security when I was 13 years old. We do.
Well, hopefully you're getting it. Some of that back.
I am starting to collect. Yeah. This is a change in the world. It's not just that kids are not playing. They're not also not feeling the joy of being a contributing member of the family.
Yeah.
And they're not feeling the responsibility and joy, I might add, of having your own independent job where you're learning something really about the work world and you're earning money that is truly your money. You can spend it on whatever you want because you earned it.
And as you said, that's a joyful feeling.
That's a wonderful feeling. And that's part of the freedom that I'm talking about that kids are missing today. So, you know, when kids are so under the control, so under the thumb of their parents at home and teachers at school, that they're just not learning how to be independent.
Yeah, and I raise that because even you're raising the locus of control is that when the children, you know, say you're on a farm and I'm speaking to somebody and the children are actually literally taking care of the animals where if they didn't do their work, the animal might die. So it's like, I have control. I'm aiding the growth of this animal in our family. Because I can totally see, and I've seen this myself when I'll say, oh, well, children need a little bit more freedom. They need to enjoy themselves, play a little bit more. If I go the other end and tell people, well, you know, it'd be great if even in these kind of middle-class homes, you can find a way in which they are a part of like dinner. Like they're setting the table, not, you know, oh, you've got to do your chores, but it's if the table's not set, then we can't have dinner. It's a part of it. And I think I get a lot of pushback though. Children shouldn't be quote working or doing things. They should just be playing. So I know that's not your view, but it seems like there's something underlying it, which I think you're emphasizing is maybe that freedom to actually do things and here to contribute. But that's why I'm raising it, because I think the pushback would be they should just be playing all day long.
Well, here's a little known fact that I wish more people knew, that there is a lot of research showing that when children are 2 and 3 years old, they want to help. They want to sweep the floor. They want to help their mom clean up. They want to help their dad. And in traditional cultures, so there's actually research on this. So, for example, in Mayan cultures, this is very much welcome because the people realize that even though this little child who wants to help is not actually providing much help, you're going to probably have to do it over again anyway, and maybe they're even slowing you down by helping you. What they recognize is if you allow them to help at that age, they will continue to help you over years, and they will just assume this is part of being the family, is helping out. Little kids really want to help, and what we discourage it. So by the time they're old enough to actually be helpful, they no longer feel like this is part of what they should be doing. I think that if we just, as I point out in that particular blog post, if we just allow children to do what they want to do when they're young, when they really do want to help us out, even though it's going to slow us down a little bit, they will become real helpers by the time they're 5 or 6 years old.
And I couldn't agree more. And as people that know Montessori, it's an integrated part of the classroom where children. But I think that one of the difficulties is that people would need to slow down a little bit. Because as you said, there's no way a child's going to be able to, let's even tie in the shoes might take 15 minutes where we want them to get it done, you know, the product.
You have to slow down, and you have to, as you pointed out about washing the tables, you have to lower your standards a little bit.
Yeah.
And I think you have to recognize it's really more important that my child feels part of the family, my child is doing this, than that my table be perfectly clean.
Yes. You know? Yeah. Right? I think we're getting over about where the time's at here. So, is there anything you know, at the end here, I don't even know if we got through the full play definition, but I think it's pretty good so far. But is there anything else that you might want to, you know, tell parents, tell teachers out there, something, advice, anything from your research, anything you want really here in closing up?
Well, I think the one thing I might add, and it's kind of been implied in what we've been talking about, but I've written a lot about the fact that over the same decades that we have gradually been taking children's freedom away from them and gradually been having them spend more and more time in school, more and more time under adult direction, less and less time playing, exploring, following their own interests, over this period of time, that we've seen huge decreases in children's freedom. We've seen huge increases in all sorts of mental disorders of childhood and young adulthood. Huge increases, no comparison. I mean, the rates of anxiety, depression, childhood suicide are way, way greater than they were in the past.
Yeah.
And you'd have to read my writing to see the arguments, because there's not time to do it now, but there is, in my mind, no question but what there's a causal link. When you take children's freedom away from them, and when you put them more or less always in situations where being judged and evaluated by adults, these are anxiety-provoking situations, you are going to produce children who are depressed, anxious, and sometimes even suicidal. And that is the tragedy of our times. So it's not... play is not a luxury for children. Play is a necessity. And if we want our children to grow up psychologically and psychologically and socially healthy, we have to stop being so concerned about testing and academic.
Yeah.
There's no evidence that all of this homework, all this focus of academia, that even in terms of academic learning, there's no evidence they're learning more than they would be if they were spending half as much time on that. So we need to go in the other direction. We need to reduce the amount of time that children are spent under adult direction and increase the amount of time that they have to learn how to take care of themselves, which they do through play.
And I think, I mean, it's a tough thing to end on, but I think you're 100% right. And definitely in my understanding of psychology and just development over the years, and even coming full circle to that locus of control, one of the things with anxiety and depression, definitely in suicide, is that I can't control my life.
Right.
You know, and that is like one of the core elements of it. And it goes back to, you know, the child's development, where he didn't learn to control his life. The teacher and his parents have been controlling his life his whole life. So how would we expect him to, you know,
right.
do it later? So yeah, it's a tough note to end on, but I think it is powerful. We're trying to aid children so that they enjoy life, not end up being miserable in it. So, Well, thank you again for coming on. Really appreciate your work. And I'm no doubt the audience will learn something here for sure. So thanks again.
And thank you. Thank you for your interest in this.
Coming out of this conversation with Peter, I want to highlight two quick things. First, mixed ages. If nothing else, I hope the idea of having children in classrooms with only peers of the same age is looking, you know, increasingly ridiculous for listeners who are new to Montessori. I mean, that age-segregated classrooms are still dominant today is crazy to me. I think it's evidence of kind of just how backward a lot of our culture still is. I mean, everyone's arguing about, let's say, the injustice of this or that thing in our world today. But meanwhile, some of these same people also, you know, happen to be parents, and they're sending their children to school to sit next to peers of the exact same age. And this is like over a decade of schooling. So it's kind of nuts. Incidentally, if you're listening and ever have some pushback like on this, by all means, write in. You know, I've just never heard a rational argument against mixed ages. You know, criticism of this is usually packaged with broader commentary about, you know, quote, progressive school, which of course can mean anything today because so many people and groups claim the word progressive. It's actually one of the reasons why I don't use that word for myself or Montessori. Anywho, mixed ages, a wonderful thing in my humble opinion. Okay, second highlight. I just want to note that discussion around, you know, quote, academics, and it's a word that came up earlier a couple times, it's really challenging, and that's unless we dive into it. So as a quick example, I am hugely against drill and kill testing, as children just learn very little from taking things like bubble tests. Now, they might regurgitate words that we want them to say, but that's not genuine learning. You know, a parakeet can do that. However, there is so much knowledge about the world, and this is developed over centuries of human growth, that children definitely can gain to aid their life. I mean, we're talking content in fields as diverse as math, literature, science, geography, and et cetera. It goes on and on. I'm raising this because I don't want the choices in education to seem like it's free play versus stilted academics, because gaining real knowledge can and should be fun. I think Peter Gray would probably say the same, but I just want to put it out there, at least in regard to myself and Montessori, that academics, and I'm talking truly speaking, so not forced and boring memorization, but meaningful, deep personal engagement with learning in different subject areas, is essential to success. Again, this would take a lot to defend, but I wanted to get it out there so this episode doesn't sound like, hey, let your kids run around free outside all day, ensure it's mixed ages, and life will be great. Because I'm going to say it right now, no, it would not be great, you know? And interestingly enough, sometimes children in Montessori, they literally choose what might be called academic work over play. I mean, just a couple days ago, actually, a Montessori teacher, she shared this story with me about there was this five-year-old girl who, busy working with these Montessori math bead chains to count to 1,000, actually, she asked if she could stay inside the classroom to continue throughout her free play time. Like, she just really wanted to finish. She was loving the learning, the academics, that much. I welcome pushback, so bring it if you have it. I'm definitely curious everyone's take on the issues I'm raising here. All right, that is all I wanted to add. A big thanks again to Professor Peter Gray for coming on. The man is a wealth of information, as you know if you've ever read his work, such as his book, Free to Learn. Now, you can find out more about Peter and what he does at letgrow.org. That's an organization he co-founded to help children experience a little bit more freedom growing up. And as always, if you enjoyed this episode or, you know, the podcast overall, please take a moment to rate or review it or leave a comment somewhere or spread this thing in any creative and free way you want. You can also always reach me and listen to more of the show and do some other things at MontessoriEducation.com. And, you know, since Thanksgiving is right around the corner, I want to offer a personal thanks to those of you who have already left reviews for the show on Apple Podcasts. I've said it before, but I'll say it again. They really do bring a smile to my face. So thank you. Okay, adios for now.